Every death that occurs from an asbestos exposure could be prevented.
Don't be fooled. There is a connection.
Everything just ties together.
I don't know what I can do.
It's hard to describe what ADAO has been in my life. I certainly can't imagine it without ADAO.
We've come a long way, and I'm really proud of ADAO.
Keep me in your heart for a while.
Well, thank you. It was a great lunch, and I know as a scientist you've come back with your bodies all set to metabolize and relax. And being from New York, I've come with a gimmick that's going to guarantee that if you stay alert during my presentation at the very end, you're going to see some 3D slides. So I'm going to talk about the science of monsters. So what do we know about monsters? Childhood monsters are invisible, and that's true of the monster I'm going to be talking about today. Childhood monsters are imaginary. Not so with the one I'm going to discuss today. And childhood monsters are harmless. No way. The monster tale starts in the little town of Libby. You're all familiar with it by now. It's a lovely place. I've had the privilege of going there a half dozen times over the last decade. Just a beautiful, beautiful part of Montana, packed up near the Canadian and Idaho border. But as you know, vermiculite was mined for more than a half a century. It was a very dirty process, and it produced what the companies called nuisance dust. And here's a picture of the vermiculite. You can see that it is just harmless-looking little chunks of lightweight rock that is about 1/8 of an inch to 1/4 inch in size. But it's the dust that's associated with it, the asbestos fibers, that have caused so much grief in Libby, Montana. We've seen that hundreds of people in and around Libby have died from asbestos-related diseases, and more are on the fast track. And it's because of that that just 2 years ago, the EPA declared its first and only public health emergency, Little Libby, Montana. And here's the monster. Those thin fibers you see that are ubiquitous in the vermiculite from Libby are what are getting into the lungs and causing all the problems that Dr. Black and others have discussed. Briefly, Dr. Black has discussed the pathology of Libby asbestos, very rapid disease progression. And what's frightening is last night when I was talking with him, he said that this is being seen in people who are not occupationally exposed, but rather those who just happen to be unfortunate enough to be living in the Libby area. If you take a look at Libby, downtown here, on the beautiful Kootenai River, the mine was up here. About 6 years ago, Tony Ward at the University of Montana sent me some samples of tree bark. I was skeptical. There's not going to be any asbestos in the tree bark. I looked, and sure enough, when we looked at the tree bark from around the mine up here, it was loaded with asbestos. And what was most troublesome, or perplexing initially, was right here on the west side of town, we got a sample of tree bark that had 5.5 million fibers per square centimeter. Now, a square centimeter is about the size of my little fingernail. I cut my fingernail short. That's about a square centimeter. 5 million fibers on that size of tree bark. Where did it come from? Because we know that the winds go from west to east in Libby. So how could this stuff get up here? Well, a little more thought and research, and we saw how this probably got there. If you look at this map of Montana with Libby up in the corner here, all these red dots represent mesothelioma. Every red dot is somebody with mesothelioma. You don't see the mesothelioma around these small little mines down here. Where's the mesothelioma? It's along the railroad tracks. They shipped millions of tons of vermiculite all over the country. And as these trains sped through the countryside, they spread the nuisance dust with the asbestos. And they spread it all over North America. This is a map of the United States showing where the vermiculite processing plants were. And the vermiculite processing plants were very dirty, dusty operations. The dark circles are plants that were in operation for more than a quarter of a century. So you can see that W.R. Grace spread its contamination all over the country. And because of that, here's an example of a grant that's gone up to up to Minnesota. There is a large W.R. Grace plant in Minneapolis, and so ATSDR and the Minnesota Health Department are looking at people who lived in the neighborhood of that processing plant during its operation to see what kind of incidence of asbestos-related diseases there are. So it goes even further, even beyond the boundaries of those three dozen processing plants, because they sold vermiculite attic insulation. Here you go. Danny K, buy your zonalite. Save 40% on insulation in your home by just taking this bag of stuff and dumping it between the floor joists in your house. So during the decade of the 1970s, more than 500,000 tons of vermiculite attic insulation was put into homes in the United States. So that today, as many as 35 million homes, businesses, and schools have vermiculite attic insulation. I'm going to talk just briefly on a study that came out last year. It's zonalite. Now, zonalite is the brand name of the vermiculite attic insulation that was being used from Libby. And this is done by Bill Ewing, Steve Hayes, Richard Hatfield, Bill Longo, and Jim Millett. Now, Jim Millett is here. Jim, could you stand up for a second just so people see who you are? So if they have technical questions, they can ask you later. Thanks, Jim. So what they did was, well, first of all, let me give you some background on airborne asbestos concentrations. The most definitive analysis is TEM, transmission electron microscope. That is the only instrument that can detect the smallest of the fibers that get into your lungs. And number two, the only instrument that can positively identify that fiber as asbestos. When we give results, we give those in structures per cubic centimeter. And again, using my little pinky, a cubic centimeter, I've got 3 cubic centimeters in the tip of my little finger. So that's the volume that I'm using as a reference. As a little background, school clearance concentrations must be 0.02 structures per cubic centimeter before they stop the abatement, before they can clear an abatement project. So the investigators looked at 3 houses, probably one of those looks like your house, that had the zonalite attic insulation. In one house, they had zonalite right here where the floor joists and the rafters come together, and they poured zonalite in there, and they used a shop vac to clear out the zonalite. And they got 1.47 structures per cubic centimeter. Another house, they cut a hole in the ceiling under the zonalite insulation, and they got 2.5 structures per cubic centimeter. Another attic, they swept with a broom, and they got 4 structures per cubic centimeter. See where I'm going? And then W.R. Grace had this method for safely removing this material from your attic. You spray it down, you'd mist it, then you go into the scoop and scoop it up and put it into a garbage bag and take it out and it's gone. Well, after they'd removed this small amount of zone light insulation, they had 6.5 structures per cubic centimeter. And then they did what a panicked homeowner would do or an ignorant homeowner would do, and that is they just went up there with a dustpan and just shoveled the stuff out. And of course they got 13 structures per cubic centimeter. So let me ground truth that a little bit and say again, a cubic centimeter is just a very small volume of air, and there are 1,000 cubic centimeters in a liter of air, and a liter of air is about what you take in with a normal inhalation and exhalation. So you do the math, and that's 13,000 fibers per breath in the attic. The EPA developed about 3 years ago, and again, Jim Millett was involved in this, a bunch of other scientists, where we worked on a method for analyzing this as a bulk material. And it was a very cumbersome method where we would take the vermiculite attic insulation, put it into water, then we would remove the floating vermiculite with a spoon or whatever. We'd siphon off the water, and then that would leave a slurry of heavier material, and the ampable fibers or chunks would be in the in what we called the sinks. And then you'd go through very laboriously with a stereo microscope and pick out the bundles of fibers that you could find with that light microscope. Now, if you look here, you see in the Petri dish this one little bundle about the size of rice, and I'm going to show that to you a little bit later with the 3D glasses, just so you get some idea of what that little rice kernel represents. And in a bag of vermiculite insulation, there would be thousands of these little bundles. But so what? If you come up with a weight percent, what does it mean from a health perspective? Well, it means absolutely nothing, because there are no standards by which we can determine what the suspension of fibers into the air is going to be from a certain weight of vermiculite attic insulation. So over the last, 3 years, I think, we've been working on what we are terming the New York Minute Method, but I think it's going to be named after a couple of our revered and deceased colleagues from EPA before it's put out. But it's a much simpler method that is much more meaningful, I think. There have been 8 laboratories working on this, including the U.S. Geological Survey, OSHA out in Salt Lake City, Jim Millett's laboratory, Millett Vanderwood Associates, EPA Forensic Laboratory out in Denver, Research Triangle Institute, Reservoirs Laboratory in Denver, and finally, our laboratory up in Albany. It's a real simple method. We found it to be very good. You look at a drop of the suspended material. Here it is right here. It's cloudy. It's cloudy because there's a lot of fibers in there. You look at a drop of water with the TEM. If it's Libby stuff, it's positive. If it's not Libby stuff, it's clean. So it's a qualitative test, but it's going to tell you whether or not the stuff you've got in your attic is Libby stuff and you have to be worried about it, or it might be from some other source where it might not be a problem. Also from the work that we did with the suspension of asbestos in water, if you look at the horizontal axis here, this is a weight percentage of asbestos in the vermiculite attic insulation, and we've seen concentrations as high as, up 5%. But typically it's around 1 to 2% by weight. And then we took a look at the how many fibers were in each gram of the vermiculite attic insulation. If you don't understand that, it's okay, because what I'm pointing at right now is that if you had a 1% by weight, you would have about 12 million fibers per gram based on what we did with the water suspension. So if we do the math there, you've got 1% with 12 million fibers per gram, a 25-pound bag, which is 11,400 grams, would contain 137 billion fibers. So that's what's in the attics. I just came across this week from an interesting website called libbyissues.org. Has anybody seen this before? libbyissues.org. I can kind of guess who wrote it, but there was no affiliation located that I could discern. It's an FAQ. Question being, is all asbestos-form tremolite removed in the processing of vermiculite ore? And the answer is, and I can almost hear one of those 1950s type of commercials where they talk about being safe, duck and cover, those sorts of things. When Grace processed vermiculite, it also performed air sampling tests. During the mid-80s, all measurements showed airborne concentrations below reliably detectable levels. As a result, we believe that when our products were used in accordance with instructions, they posed no unreasonable health risk. So, I don't think that was the ADAO that wrote that, was it? Brent, was it EIA? No, I've got some thoughts. We can share those later. So let's apply that statement that he just made with this picture of Bing Crosby in his blazer and tie saying, you know, this stuff is so clean and healthy, I can do it in full dress and it's no problem. So let's take a look at this disclaimer that I just read. They pose no unreasonable health risk when used in accordance with instructions. The only instructions I can think of that they could have put on that bag was do not open. But that's not the case today. So hundreds of millions of these bags were opened in attics across America. We've got now tens of thousands of attics with this material up there. People don't know about it. It's a monster in the attic. Yes, it's invisible, but it's unfortunately real, and it's deadly. So thank you for paying attention up this far, and now we're going to go to the glasses. This is one of the grad students I taught in a scanning electron microscopy course, so put the blue lens over the left eye, so if I see black, you've got them on backwards. There you go. You want to have the white facing out. Okay? So that's a scanning electron microscope where Amanda took all those pictures. Remember that piece of rice I showed you? Well, this is the tip of that. And if you look right down here, I scratched it with a needle. And look what happens when I uncovered it with that needle. That's the furrow from the needle. Look at those fibers sticking out at the side. More fibers from that bundle. More fibers. Fibers galore. Another little piece of rice. It looks fairly harmless, but when you look close, it's those fibers that get into the lungs. Another little plate-like piece. Same story. Millions of fibers in these bundles. And what's fascinating here is you look in this little crevice here, and I'm going to go up in magnification here, but they say, these are all cleavage fragments. Well, somehow that doesn't quite look like a cleavage fragment, does it? And then here's some bark that I was telling you about. When you look closely at the bark, you can start to see fibers. Pay attention to this little grain right here. You can see maybe a couple of fibers, large fibers at low magnification. You go up in magnification, and you start to see these fibers like this. You go up again in magnification, and you see a fiber down here. You go up again in magnification, and you see another little fiber down here that you didn't see before. So no matter what magnification you're looking at, you're seeing fibers, and all those fibers can break up into smaller fibers and get into the lungs. So here's a study one of my grad students did with Libby amphiboles and human lung cells. And that is it. Thank you very much.
But thanks for coming, and thanks for making this the most successful conference thus far.
Keep me in your heart.